So you begin to start off maybe doing some background movements, far distant background buildings. If we go to here, so you've got these more complicated buildings just here. What these are, these done in almost the same kind of way, but I want to get some kind of perspective going first, because there's a chance that some of these, I want these to follow the Vavian perspective. You might or might not have installed on your Photoshop a script called Percreate, Perspective Create, Horizon, Rename, etc. But if they're not on your Photoshop, then I'll put them on Blackboard in the same place I'll put the rest of this kind of stuff. What this does is allow you to extract the perspective of an image or a photo. The way you do that is you go to the pen tool, and you're going to find, what you want to do is you want to find two lines that you know in reality are parallel to each other. So I'm going to go for this part of this window here, and then I'm going to click to the end just here. And then you hold control and you click once. And then I'm going to go this end and this end, just click and control click. So I've created two lines here. Once you've got those two lines, you'll go to scripts, Percreate. Will ask you for a multiplier. That number means the higher the number, the more perspective lines it's going to give you. Let's give it 2. And then it will think for a bit. And it will give these nice, give you a vanishing point. And it will give you these lines on a new layer. And what you can do with this layer is some people like to color code it. So you can put maximum saturation and put this up so you know that these ones are going to be the perspective lines there towards that vanishing point. And then I might want to do another vanishing point that sort of goes in the other way. But I mean, to be honest, this one point perspective might well be enough because we're really just going to be drawing stuff off. And we're looking really so that when we make our lines that proceed into the distance, these massive tall buildings that are closer to us, they sort of generally follow these diagonal lines heading off towards the vanishing point just here. So, there are distant buildings. Next building should be another layer. Exactly the same sort of thing. Just sort of make it up. Don't be afraid of having the buildings disappear off the frame as well. That's going to accentuate how big they are. So I'm using a perspective line here so I know that that line is roughly right. I always like to get this sort of indent to the view like that. Oops. Sorry, I had the old instruction still. So let's do that again. Best to start off with broad shapes and then with like maybe a normal rectangular marquee selection, but it was add. Just sort of begin adding bits onto it like this. Just build up the shape. And that, and maybe also then, every now and again, cut stuff away from it. Like that. And then the same technique as before, you fill that with the sky. Let's go to quick selection. Oh, sorry, I've covered it because I'm stuck on it selected. Do something along that sort of line. Bring that building back into sort of existence. Remember that the closer something is to the camera, the darker it's going to pretend to be. You want to fade stuff out. So they're almost melting away to nothing when they get really distant. And the more layers, the more planes you have with these kind of values changing, the more depth you're going to give your early picture. Or you're going to give your painting that painting. So you do that kind of thing. Whoops. Not here. Let's bring that back again. Yeah. Something like this all on separate layers, so that if you need to, you can adjust the varying kind of opacity of these things. Now, the difference with these foreground buildings compared to the background ones, these ones look like they've got detail going on. Right? And again, I didn't paint this. What I did was, I did searches for things like aircraft carriers, oil refineries, and again, sort of brutalist architecture. Because you can use those to texture. So let's load up this aircraft carrier. It's got tons of this cool kind of mechanical, techie kind of detail. This would be good as well when you do your CGI project, because great inspiration to, for all this sort of extraneous kind of high tech, but also sort of functional looking details. And if you add this to sort of bar space and stuff, it's just going to make it even more realistic. It's great stuff to texture as well in Photoshop. And the way you kind of go around texturing is, well, first of all, I'm going to actually make it black and white. You chop off a bit that you think is going to be good for texturing, sort of roughly following the perspective. Control C to copy that. On a layer, a new layer on top of here, you paste it down like this, and then you use the free transform to sort of move it into position and to scale it. Fairly loose with this, and then you might need to distort it as well to sort of get it back to looking like it's the front on side of the building. Do something like that. Click yeah. At the moment, you want it to only go on onto the building, so you select the building layer by control clicking the building layer's actual little thumbnail, and then you hold Control, Alt, and Shift all together, and you click that new bit of texture detail. What that does, it kind of cookie cutters out like that. So it gives you the line that goes around for Control, Shift, I. Now I can delete it. Oops, wrong layer. Sorry. And then if I delete it, it sort of cuts out the texture and conforms it to the shape of the building shape that you've done. And now, if I choose the layer mode to overlay, I can get it as a texture like this. Dial it back because I just want to hit. That's it. And what you can do to sort of give a fake sense of 3D is you can duplicate it. Control T sort of free transform it, and again distort it, but this time sort of distort it so it looks like it's kind of receding into perspective like this. That looks out of my perspective actually. And you begin to get that kind of fake 3D look. Now the more time you spend on finding some nice textures, the more time you spend in placing them and warping them into shape, the better. You want to look for a variety of shapes, so they're not all the same. So I think this came from a sort of a brutalist kind of high rise, or a car park or something, I think, and that this was the actual battleship. And it's a matter of adding more and more things onto it, so then it's like the lights that you want to create. If you want to create some lights, you very much like we did with our day tonight, in fact, absolutely identical technique on the day tonight shot of the city. You find an image with some nice lights in, make a little rough selection, copy and paste, move them up into position, and then if you need to, and you probably will do, you want to sort of rotate them. Them and normally put them in where they're going to show them the best, normally in sort of like areas of darker kind of contrast. Something like that. And the blending mode would be linear dodge. Instantly it would be too bright. And then to get rid of that, bring levels of it, which really crunch the blacks like that. So only the brightest blacks can shut through. So, I mean, you instantly get yourself like a high tech looking kind of building that's sitting there with not much work. I mean, within 10 minutes, but imagine if you spent, you know, like half an hour to an hour or something like that, you could really fine tune it and get it looking exactly like you want. I did a similar thing with these lines here that sit on the top of these spines. Oh, yeah, to create extra kind of quick, sort of spiky, spiry kind of bits. Again, I'll use, much like I did with the these kind of telephone wires, I'll use the straight line tool. I'll just give it a thicker kind of value. And then it's a bit like just painting, you know, sort of big, quick sort of rectangles to create spikes and stuff like that. Just going in there and spending more and more time. So, to get those kind of bright lights that sit on the end of the spires, I didn't want to paint it, I want to guess what a light looks like on a distant kind of gantry or a skyscraper. So instead, I literally just copied out one of these lights, pasted it around, put it to linear dodge, pasted it all around to kind of see where I thought it would make some sense. At one point, you might want to do something, you might want to simulate what's called light wrap, which is, well, this is a bit of a combination between light wrap and atmosphere. So you might want to create, at some point, an extra layer that goes on top of one of the lights. This is maybe the only bit of actual painting you're kind of going to be doing, but even then it's not really paint as such. You want the big soft sort of airbrush. Pick the colour of the sky on its own separate layer with a really low opacity. Just kind of brush slightly over the top just to sort of soften the edges. Make it look like it just adds a little bit. It stops it from being a pure gradient and a pure sharp silhouette. Keep on doing this until you have built up the kind of buildings that you want. And then I would then collapse. Maybe merge the layers into the main building, so you've got the textures there. Let's just see. So it's that texture, that actual building. So I merge the layers, just got a bit of the texture showing through there. I grouped in this in terms of these foreground buildings and these background buildings in different layers. Once you've merged the layers, you know, it's just a little bit easier to deal with. And then the next step is when you begin, you just carry on polishing to it and adding to it. You can have as many different cool little lights and things as you want. The last thing you've got to do, though, is create an alpha channel before you bring it into After Effects. The alpha channel is a sort of simulates in some ways like a traditional map painting app would have looked. The alpha channel forms that hole that sort of gets punched out. So the alpha channel to this image looks like that because really this is the only part of the painting is going to get used. Everything that's red is going to be live action. Everything up here is going to be painting. One way to create the alpha channel is you have a look at it, you decide what part of the image is going to be live action, what part's not. And with the lasso tool, draw a selection. It's going to be a bit like that. And then you want it to be a soft selection, so you want any kind of blend, potential kind of overlap between the painting and the live action that might show through. You want at least to have a soft kind of blend. So if something goes wrong, something sort of appears from painting to live action, then it's at least it's going to be soft as opposed to like this hard edge. So if you make that selection and then you feather that selection by going to modify, feather. But on this image, I've had 30. It was more than enough. So I've got a selection now with a sort of feathered edge of 30. And if you're in channels with a selection, if you hit that button here, it looks like the layer mask, it'll create a new channel that looks like that. And that's going to be your alpha channel. So this is good to go into After Effects now. I'll do it on this really scrappy one I've done quick. Let's just get rid of that aperture. Because I'm going to create that new one. So again, I'm just going to go up to here. All the way up to here. Finish our selection. And I'm going to feather it by 30. Create a new channel. That's good now to save out. Try and keep, I'm not sure how you enjoy it in your copying class. This is just how I do it. Just create a bunch of subfolders so organized. It's a lot like the Maya database, except you've got to kind of make it yourself, which has its advantage in terms of deletion or getting a ton of extra folders you don't need. But at the same time, I guess you've got to make it yourself. So I'm going to save this into painting. Save it as a target. Pretty much anything that will support Alpha Channel is all you really need. Make sure that Alpha Channel is clicked on and save. Right, so back into After Effects. If I start a new composition, save, so bring back in my plate. And then bringing in the photo in the painting. Lecture motion. With Targa, After Effects, I mean, at one point you'll move on to Nuke and you won't have to worry about this as much. With Targa, what we're doing, we want straight and unmatted, you know, all pre-multiplied to happen. It gets even more complicated because Photoshop deals with transparency in its own peculiar way as well. If you drag the painting on top of your plate like this, and you're going to align the two. Should be fairly easy. Essentially, it'll be like that. You did it right, it's seamless. Now, when you move through the timeline, you've got whatever your live action is with your painting on top. Now, to do the tilt, do this kind of fake tilt again. I'm imagining you've probably done this in your club. All you have to do is parent your painting to your original plate. And then on your original plate, you're just going to keyframe the position. So you make a keyframe at the start, and at the end, you know, pull that down a bit. You'll know when you hit the point where you've run out of painting. You do that, so it's got two keyframes. And then you can set both keys and just apply a quick, easy ease to them. So now your painting is going to follow your live action plane perfectly. I went with just a couple of extra things I did on my finished kind of one. I put in a bit of, when you download that file, you'll also see in here the smoke, right? What I did was, it's just a bit of sort of smoke, well, it's like you imagine it, so it's just a burst of live action smoke. I inverted it, because I actually wanted it, it's kind of white smoke against black, and I wanted it the other way around. So, I got this, and positioned it to where I wanted it to be, sort of rescaled it. But it's got a hard edge, so I just applied some quick masks to this. Draw like that and make that a subtractive mask. And then feather it. Just a bit of a soft edge. And again, you need another mask as well because the top of it kind of disappears as well. And feather that one as well. Oh yeah, I think I also think the smoke moved just a little bit too quick. So if you want to slow it down, super easy way is just time stretch it by maybe 200. the vessels are scaled. And then scale it, position it where you want it to. I think it would be good then. Probably, again, if you want it in the far distance, you don't want to mess around with the opacity of it when you take it down, because it's just barely showing. Add parent lamp as well to your original. So again, then you have some smoke. Anything you can do to avoid tracking, if you can, do it. And then you can just render it out and you've got your back plate. So it's all about getting it to look relatively decent. It's just spending time on the design element of it. You know, flex your design muscle with your creative urges and actually try and come up with something that looks sort of interesting. I want you guys to have a go in a moment. And, you know, don't feel like you have to have futuristic kind of buildings. Maybe you want to put a planet in there instead, or something like that, or just, I don't know, whatever you feel like you don't mind. I would just like to see you have a go at this kind of workflow, where you're doing a lot of stuff that you did last semester in terms of extracting the sky, and then you're kind of thinking about building up layers from the back to the front, and then bringing it into After Effects. I'll come around and I'll help if you forgotten about how to do any certain thing in Photoshop, things like that. And this is going to tie in. I want for the rest of the session, have a go at this. Your homework for next week is to shoot your own plate, right? And if you want to get cracking on it in your free time, I will give you next session to work on it as well. But I'd like you to be, because I'm going to start grading you on these map paintings, right? It's part of the assignment. I'm going to be more impressed the more ambitious you are, essentially. So if it's just a locked off camera and you've done a sky thing, and that's like you barely did it, right? Think about stuff that's going to look as well invisible, stuff that's going to look like it isn't an effect shot. I was thinking a good thing to try to do would be a set extension, right, on one of the buildings here. Why not shoot one of your friends coming out of, say, Flaxman, at ground level, and as they, either as they come out and then afterwards tilt the camera up, or the opposite, have the camera tilt down to make Flaxman building look, I don't know, three or four times bigger than it actually is. You should have the Photoshop skills to be able to do that by now. So I'm going to be particularly impressed if you do map paintings where the average person on the street wouldn't even know if they were looking at an effect shot, but you've made the building look like twice as big, or something along that kind of line. Again, I want you to be a bit creative about that. But for now, for this session, just to get used to it, get to grips with the whole process of loading your plate into After Effects, exporting it to Photoshop, beginning to build the painting by extracting the stuff you need, and then just putting anything in there initially, and see if you can get it back into After Effects. It's not that complicated. It's not too bad. Do it one or two times, and I think you're going to have it down. And then you'll realize that it takes time. The bit that takes time is purely if the more adventurous you get in making stuff up off the top of your head, that's the stuff that takes time. If you, to be honest, doing Z extension, you're probably a bit quicker because